Okay, Josh Lavine is here with us today. Josh has been, as some of you have already heard on the BHE pod, talking about his new developmental framework of the centers and object relations. And today we wanted to get on here and talk about the implications of this way of looking at object relations in the centers for typing. And to take advantage of this medium, looking at videos, we've teed up a bunch of videos and also have Josh look at another center and explain some more about what's going on from this framework. And he's got a course that's going on right now with, that he's teaching with John, that if you guys want to get into this deeper, you can take advantage of that. So take it away, Josh.
Sweet. Thanks for having me on, guys. I'm excited to be here. So yeah, John and I are teaching a class on this new developmental theory of the centers. You can check it out at theenneagramschool.com. And the class is almost over, but you can pay for access to the recordings of them. And they're really rich. They've been really, really, really good. Just really interesting, rich material and good questions from people and stuff like that. But so it's been helpful to flesh some stuff out. The centers of intelligence are like, you know, foundational to the Enneagram. And I think that in a lot of the typing work that you guys have been doing, it's the centers have become, well, central in like, it's one of the foundational things. And you're also, it's like some intersection of center and object relational affect. And those are the two like foundational things that are the psychological blueprint of type. Mm-hmm. And I've been thinking a lot about that. And I also was just sitting with a lot of inconsistencies that I felt were in the traditional framing of object relations regarding the nurturing and protective function. I'm not going to go into that whole thing. You can listen to the BHE episode about that. And I also felt that that the centers were the wooest part of the Enneagram. Like they were the most ungrounded in you might call like Western academic psychology. And I've been doing a lot of reading about developmental psychology, mostly from an adult development point of view, ego development. But I started thinking about the centers themselves as a developmental framework as a result of some of that reading. And the basic idea is that in the first year of infancy, I think that you kind of in a stage by stage sequence go from body to heart to mind. So like, you know, you are born and in the first week or a few weeks of life, you're basically just a body. Your eyes have not constellated yet to be able to even focus on individual people. You can't distinguish between objects in your environment. You're just awash in a sensory surround. And the first existential dilemma arises, how do I protect myself from the bombardment of irritating sensations in this new environment? That's the body center's main concern. How do you set up boundaries? How do I be separate from this environment or protect myself? Then around 4 weeks old, this is approximate, around 4 weeks old, an infant develops the ability to actually track objects in its environment, actually direct its attention at things. And if you hold like a 4 or 5 week old baby, you'll notice that they're making really strong eye contact. And I think that what happens in this stage is that they begin to realize that other people, first of all, are because their eyes are focused, they actually can distinguish other people exist. And they realize that other people are paying attention to me. And not only are they paying attention to me, but certain implications come. So when people pay attention to me, my needs are getting met. When their attention is withdrawn from me, then my needs are not getting met. And sometimes when they're paying attention to me, they're also not paying attention to me in the right way. For example, like I'm hungry, but mom's changing my diaper. And so attunement becomes really important. And I think that the existential concern that arises here is how do I get the right kind of attention that actually attunes to my inner state? And at some pre-verbal, precognitive level, we become aware that my inner subjective experience of myself is not actually what other people see. And so the distinction between identity and image comes about. Mm-hmm. So we hang out here for a while, and then around somewhere between 6 and 12 months, depending on the baby, we develop something called object permanence, which is the idea that you can actually hold a symbolic representation of something that is no longer in your immediate field of vision. So like when the ball rolls under the couch, you know that it still is there. Prior to object permanence, if the ball rolls under the couch and you can't see it anymore, it's as if it ceases to exist. Uh-huh. When you have object permanence, you remember that it's there and you basically can hold the symbol of it in your mind. And I conceive of that as the birth of the mental center. And once you're in the mental center, then symbol itself becomes really important. And not just symbol, but how do you orient in a world of symbolic abstraction? For example, let me say it this way. Like, if the ball rolls under the couch and you know it's still there, questions arise. What else is under the couch? What's behind the couch? And you realize it's kind of like the infant's first experience of infinity, you know, and the terror of the mental center arises, like, oh my God, how do I know what's up and down around here? That's the concern of the mental center. So that's the centers in a developmental framework in brief. And there's a whole bunch that you can unpack and all that. And then to bring object relations into it, I think that what the object relational affects are actually in relation to, traditionally they were posited as being in relation to abstractions called the nurturing function, the protective function, and the both together, or sometimes I've heard someone call it the belonging function. It's a number of other framings. I think that what they're actually in relation to is what I'm calling like the milieu of the center. So at a body level, eight is rejecting the field of sensation, nine is attached to the field of sensation, and one is frustrated with the field of sensation. In the heart center, two is rejecting the field of gaze or attention or the way people regard me. Three is attached to that, and four is frustrated by that. And then the mental center, we have five, the rejection type, rejecting exogenous orientation, six, attached to exogenous orientation, and seven, frustrated with exogenous orientation.
And so why this is important is that it takes something that's been central to what we do that's somewhat complicated in the sense of like people are trying to understand object relations, the protecting function with the nurturing function, and it really simplifies it in a clear way. And I think it also simplifies it in a way that you can make clearer distinctions when it comes to typing, where, you know, for example, we type people every week, and we had one recently where we were stuck between three and six, but we could see the trifix instincts and everything, but for whatever reason the secondary fix was really loud, and we spent a couple of weeks going back and forth. And something that really helped me was to sort of bring it back to what is the central theme or the central underlying concern about this entire video. Like, what is, even though there's a lot of three stuff that's going on here, there's a lot of six stuff going on here, what is the central issue that's underlying everything that this person is saying? And, you know, between orientation and gaze, it made it a little bit clearer. Like, sometimes you get lost in the details, and just come down to like one central, all right, is this gaze, orientation, or a holy environment? And I think that could be helpful from a typing perspective.
Yeah, it also maybe has implications in terms of how you see trifix. Like,
absolutely.
If the nature of personality is trifix, then you have an orientation to the field of sensation or your holding environment. You have an orientation to the way that you want others to see you, and you have an orientation to orientation itself. Mm-hmm. And so that's what the structure of personality is from an Enneagram point of view, is those three things together.
You said something about that, you know, the nested quality, which, you know, we've kind of landed on before, but I think this solidifies that concept, that the way that one would hold orientation is still coming from the perspective of the core center. So like the way that I orient in the head center is still coming from the perspective of, are you a reliable character within my holding environment that I've constructed?
Yes. Yes. Yeah. And that has huge implications in terms of like how you are in the other centers is in relation to the concern of your core center in a certain sense. So like as a three, when I hold the symbolic object of, for example, David in my mind, when we're not, like if we're not in the same room together and I'm not actually looking at you, if you're existing just in my mind as a symbol, I'm holding you in relation to how I think you see me, or the way that, you know, the quality of attention that you give to me.
That gives another point to that is that, for example, Joseph has a six fix, so his sixness is going to be different from, you know, a three. You have a six fix as well, so even though there's like a generalized six fixation characteristics, the way that you both use your six fix is coming through the perspective of, you know, Joseph frustration with gaze and you attachment with gaze. That's, you know, that's interesting from a typing perspective that, you know, you could have the same fix as someone else, but if you have different core, it's going to be used differently.
There's so much built into what an Enneagram type even is. And so what this to me, what makes this really useful is that it really does, and I think we were discovering what this is, but it really does take the actual base core elements of what a type even is. Because, you know, in the past it was like, oh, what's your core fear or what's in all that stuff. It's not that that's all bullshit, but it doesn't really actually get to the core of like, what is the structure of this type? Like, what is this? What does this mean? Four isn't just envy. That doesn't really get to anything at the end of the day. But this is like frustration with gaze. You have the object relation in the center, and those two interlocking is four. Everything else you say about four, that it's withdrawn, that's whatever, like, you know, we were saying, Josh, when we talked about this, that all in some way really just describes those two base interlocking elements. And that makes the type simpler. And that makes typing simpler, hopefully.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, for example, with four, the basic fear in a lot of books talks about the fear of being insignificant or having no significance and things like that. It's just it's a very washy, vague term. And the idea of, like, as I've been looking at this, it really feels to me, this is coming from conversations with John too, but like the heart center, the heart center is also just, it's so saturated with cultural associations of love and how we feel and stuff like that. And and the sort of hallmarkification of the word heart really obscures the Enneagram definition of the word heart, which is all about how we hold our identity, how we see ourselves, our subjective experience of ourselves, and how we want others to see us. And I think that, you know, a better way of stating the core fear of four is that, you know, it's like something that I interact with will contaminate me or contaminate my identity. Like my identity will fray as a result of contact with something that I am forced to ingest, not on my own terms. You know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. The disdain reflex of the four is an identity protection mechanism. It's basically saying, I'm this thing that only I can sense that is internally generated. And then you put something in front of me, like a piece of art or music or a person, and does my interaction with this thing confirm and help me sense more deeply my own sense of identity? Or does it cause me to abandon myself? Would interacting with this thing make me turn my back on the only thing I know is precious to me, which is this internally generated sense of identity?
Okay. Yeah.
You know, object relations is how we create a false self. And in the heart center, it literally is about identity. And so we're talking about two, three, and four, how we create a false sense of self-seeing that allows us to deal with painful gaze. Like when people don't attune to us, when the gaze upon us is poor quality, or when gaze is withdrawn, the object relational affect that we take on, whether it's a choice or not, I don't think it's actually a choice, but is the way that we construct that false self. So just hanging out on four land for a second, frustration is the way that I create a self-image that is constellated around my negative reactions to whatever gets put in front of me. Yep. And so I sort of back myself into an identity corner because everything that I see is something that evokes my disdain. It's like, that's not me, that's not me, that's not me. Nope, 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 nope. I'm this thing over here. And, you know, we talk about, I think one thing that's very misunderstood is that four, you know, yes, four is a heart type, but it's not, Joseph, as you were saying in the interview that we did, like, it's a dry heart type. It's not like wet, open, you know, emotive in the way that we typically conceive of that, of the word heart. It's a, it's a heart type from the point of view that it's protecting its sense of identity, and it's dry because it creates such a narrow framing of itself that it doesn't actually feel like it. It feels like feeling certain kinds of emotions or emotional responses in relation to something would be a form of self-abandonment,
yeah, mm,
that it refuses yeah. to do. And so I'm not gonna be happy with your Hallmark card because doing so would erode my sense of self.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
you know.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
Joseph wanted more professional backdrop, so I obliged him.
By standing, killing someone and staining it with blood, staining a sheet with blood.
Yeah.
That's yeah. what. Yeah.
Opening up a vein and just letting
you know. We got to be authentic here.
It kind of looks like a Canadian flag to me, so
that works.
What's something new you learned in the past week?
How to twirl a baton.
Name one thing you couldn't live without.
My passport.
Do you have a middle name?
Yes, it's Megan. My first name is actually Rachel.
What was your favorite TV show growing up?
I Love Lucy.
What's the first role you ever auditioned for?
Hot Girl Number One in A Lot Like Love with Ashton Kutcher.
Did you get it?
Yes.
I want to set this up from the theory point of view. So we're talking about type three as the type that is attached to gaze. And from the point of view of object relations, creating a false self. Three basically, like young three, gets missed by attunement. Like somebody misses it, you know, misreads it or something. And three says, ouch, that was painful. Well, what can I do to get positive gaze now? Mm-hmm. And it constructs a false self that it presents as a proxy for it that will attract positive gaze. And it kind of gets validation by proxy of this image. And it's always, especially like what I love about this conversation with Megan here is that you can see just how open and receptive and porous she is to the interviewer. Like she is just anticipating, waiting for his question.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In a way that is like she's on the edge of her seat. You know, it's like she's taking it in. It almost is like you could see that it will have an impact inside her, the question, and she's nervous about what her answer is going to be, especially in a rapid fire context, because she doesn't have time to craft something.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be something that's just, oh, here it is.
Mm-hmm.
That moment where right before this last answer that we saw, like I felt like that was such a display of shame. Like she had to collect herself when she was remembering that she was hot girl number hot five girl number, or whatever. Yeah.
Number one.
Yeah.
And I also, you know, we talked about this when we did like Tinder Peace Theater, that episode, but I mean, we haven't watched all of it, but one thing that I think that threes and three fixers automatically do is this sense of like,
it's pinging the collective.
It's you know? Yeah, or generic sounds like mean, but it's just kind of like, it's the sense that like none of these answers are going to upset anyone and they're all relatable. My passport. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, me too. Like all of these, you can just be like, mm-hmm, me too, mm-hmm, me too, me too. Same. You know what I mean? Whereas, mm-hmm, and there's something wrong with that. But if you have a four here, they're going to just be like, what thing you can never live without? They're going to be like, my pet ferret that I painted green. Or like, I don't know. You know what I'm saying? Like,
right. Impossible to relate to.
Right, right. And so she is relational.
And she's nervous that her answer, hot girl number one, is going to paint her into too arrogant of an image, and so she has to deliver that in an apologetic way to prevent negative gaze. See what I'm saying?
That's also being influenced by when we have her typed as 3, 6, 9, and one thing I was noticing just watching this is that there is sort of like a combination affect with the trifixes. Mm-hmm. Like she's a core three, but with the 6 and 9 there's like an extra porous, attentive vibe that I've seen that other Bermudas have, where she is really paying attention. You know, like she doesn't really want to stray too far off the sort of like path of acceptability, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Splendor in the grass.
If you had to be an animal for a day, what would that animal be?
My dog Bogart. Best life ever.
Can you do an impression of anyone?
No. Although, when I get punchy late night on set, I always start to go into this like, oh, yeah, see? Come on, fellas, let's keep it moving. They like that.
So they like that? Like, she does this impression, you know, she does this impression that is like, it's interesting because it's, I think she's actually revealing something that's like, she likes doing that impression. Mm-hmm. It's right. It's kind of a vulnerable thing for her to do, you know? Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's a way, it's actually a way of like, I could imagine that when she's in a room full of people that she's really comfortable with late night, she's getting punchy. Mm-hmm. She goes into that. And she feels really psychologically safe. And she actually starts revealing like, I like doing this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But here she is now doing it in public on a public interview that's going to be televised. And she's like really nervous to pull this out, you know, and she does it in that same kind of apologetic way. And then she has to justify it to herself afterwards by throwing away that comment. They like that. You know, it's like,
right. Yeah. It's, that's why I did it.
That's attachment. Attachment to gaze.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is something subtle too, just to notice as a body type. And perhaps this is also social, or it's even more emphasized because of social, but it's kind of uncomfortable how much she's watching us watching her. Like it's an over the top degree. Like some social threes give me that impression. It's like they're really watching how you're responding, and it, you know, it feels like a lot.
Yeah.
So I'm a social three, and I like moment of self revealing here. It's like the nervousness that I feel like coming onto this call, and then this going to be a public thing in an environment where I'm not normally seen, is like I feel a very similar kind of nervousness that she feels. You know what I'm saying? So there's a certain sense, be interesting to watch this back. Like I'm feeling a little more comfortable now that we're into it, but like my sense of like, uh-oh, like camera's on, we're performing now. Always creates a heightened inner state. Just the awareness that I am on, you know, and also in this particular context for me, the focus is on me, my theory, how this relates to your work. It's like, I'm sort of like featured guest. And so it's like the hope is it comes first. Like, I hope this goes well. I hope people like it. I hope I present myself well. I hope that the gaze that I earn from this appearance is positive, you know? And the fear is that, you know, it goes terrible, or that I say something dumb, or I watch this back and it's like, oh God, I look like an idiot or something.
Got it.
Yeah, but that's what's happening with her in this conversation.
Can you say something about like from this framework, how where does competency fit or arise from the attachment to gaze for three?
Well, it might be in just a minute here. She has this answer.
Okay. Yeah, yeah.
Somebody says like, yeah, let's keep going.
Your favorite phone app.
Heads up.
How long could you last without your phone?
A scene. I can last a scene without my phone.
What's the last thing that you Googled?
Just before I walked in here, I Googled this thing about dog training. Got a new rescue dog. He needs some training.
Name a book that's had a big influence on you.
The Sound and the Fury.
What children's book can you not wait to share with your kids?
The Giving Tree.
If your life was a children's book, what would the title be?
The Glorious Adventures of Freckle-Faced Meg.
If you were a superhero, what would your power be?
Teleportation.
And what would your kryptonite be?
Wine.
What person, living or dead, would you like to grab a drink with?
Anthony Bourdain.
And what would you drink?
If I was with Anthony Bourdain, I'd drink a Negroni because I'd feel cooler.
What's a guilty pleasure of yours?
The Real Housewives of Beverly Hills.
What's a song that's guaranteed to get you dancing?
It's called Murder on the Dance Floor. It's a British song, like, I know, I know, I know, I know, I know.
What day in your life would you love to relive?
The day that I found out I got Suits.
What's your favorite scene on Suits that you were not in?
The mud bath scene. So good.
What's something you and Rachel have in common?
Our ambition.
What are you most proud of?
Being the UN advocate for women's political participation.
If your teenage self could see you now, what would she be most impressed by?
The fact that my hair's straight. I think she'd be really impressed that I'm an actress on a successful show. It's crazy.
In the other video, she it's a similar kind of situation, and she's talking about, she has this personal brand as like a lifestyle person, right? And she is asked the question, like, what do you bring to a party? And she's like, I don't think there's anything quite as impressive as a really well-roasted chicken. And she talks about the chicken for a minute. And there's just a sense of, like, where competence comes in is, from attachment to Gay's point of view, is like, I have an agenda. I want to be seen well. And I look out at the field of, like, where people's attention goes. And our culture is obsessed with high performance and achievement. And if you're backing yourself into, like, how do I get that? How do I be polished? How do I be the kind of person upon whom exogenous gaze falls admiringly? Then you just kind of formulaically figured out. Mm-hmm. So, like, oh, like, I can roast this chicken. Here's my formula. This is how you do it. I can straighten my hair. This is how you do it. I can do blah, 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 blah. And then you become this competence machine.
Mm. Competence is like doing in the image center.
Yeah.
You know, yeah. Creating, generating.
In terms of, like, we want to be really clear, because there will be people that are watching us, any type, 6, 9, whatever, that'll just be like, oh my God, I'm so nervous in front of the camera too. And I notice mm-hmm. how everybody's looking at me. Like, everybody some way has a social instinct and has a heart center. But say, what we're seeing here specifically, though, at least from the perspective of typing, is the way that she's doing this in this particularly competent way. Like, when, like, sixes say that they're nervous, but you're just like, why'd you say that ridiculous thing? Like, they're just kind of, they'll ramble or do something really awkward, or, you know, they're nervous, but they'll try to get you to, like, protect them. Like, oh my God, guys, I'm so small, I don't know what to do. Like, you know, that kind of thing is not the same as what we're seeing Megan do here. You know what I mean? I'm just trying to, like, from a typing perspective, because we're saying these things that are really relatable to everybody, including me.
True.
I get nervous on these calls too, or, you know what I mean? So it's like, but we want to be really specific about, like, why is this heart center, and why is it gaze,
and not, and why is it, you know, three?
Yeah. Why is it, for example, when we were stuck between 6 and 3 for this person that we were typing, what really we understood was that, yeah, 3 might be nervous while they're on camera, but because of the competency, there is a kind of, like, they've got it together. They're projecting the feeling that they've got it together. Whereas 6 inevitably wants to let you know that I might not have it together. I want, you know, I'm looking for some kind of orientation. I want to prove that I'm doing the right thing. And so that's a very big difference. You know, 3s might be nervous, but they're actually trying to project an image of some level of competence mm-hmm. in the image center.
And they generally successfully do.
Yeah.
You can't tell unless you're really looking when 3s are nervous. You're not going to watch this interview with Megan and be like, oh my God, she's such a spaz. She was so nervous. Right. You're not seeing that, not really.
And you can see how, depending on the quality of the question, whether it's like some answers have to be more personal than others. Like, for example, what's your guilty pleasure? Wine. You know, that kind of thing. It's like, like something true about me is coming out that you might not like.
Right.
Whereas when a question comes to her, and I can't think of one right now, but when a question hits her that she has the answer for, because she's thought about, she's figured out, it's part of her image, she kind of collects herself very quickly and she delivers the answer.
Right.
Yeah.
She is also still, and it's like 3 with social, she is still, at least, again, this is my very limited perspective on my type, but it feels like she's pulling from tropes already. Housewives like wine, and that's cool. I've seen that already. I've seen that meme about, like, hashtag wine mom, so I can say wine, and that's the right she's dropping the right thing for the, you know, the right gaze.
Yes,
she knows how to do the right thing and for the gaze that she wants. Yeah,
like 6 is that's kind of what I mean by the doing. It's like the 3 is sort of directing their own gaze movie or something, that makes sense. And it's more of a, has a soloist feel to it, even though 3 is pinging the collective. At the same time, it's that competency thing that, you know, they're going to do this on their own, whereas 6 is fishing around for support in various ways. And that's why they're doing this sort of apologetic stuff in there, or being whatever, silly.
Remember that, you know, the primary concern of the heart center is identity itself. And how do I sense me, me-ness, like personalness, mm-hmm. what is who I really am. And as we were talking about before, the four are frustrated is like, only I can sense it. I have an inner standard by which I sense it. And anything that is going to contaminate or disrupt that, I feel resentful of. Whereas three takes the unconscious approach of allowing what other people value, so exogenous gaze, wash out my inner sense of self.
Yeah.
And so my identity gets populated by the things that I see other people value. And so, Joseph, to your point about like, she's pulling from these tropes, yes, because that, you know, the inner mental space of three is populated with things that I notice other people like.
Those things have value in the eyes of other people.
You know what happened last time we were promoting you? Did you hear the story?
No.
We were promoting you all morning, saying, coming up. And then we get a call from the producer saying, actually, he's still in LA. You weren't here. You weren't in the city. You weren't in Australia.
I wished I was here.
Our mistake, not yours, Billy.
But good to see you finally here on the couch. You've recently released your ninth studio album, Monuments to an Elegy, right? Tell us about that. How's this one feel for you?
I don't know. It's always a bit weird because when you're making an album, you think it's one thing and then the public tells you it's something else. And then eventually it's somewhere in between what you thought and what they thought. So a lot of people thought it was sort of a throwback to the old kind of sound, which I didn't feel. But people seem to be happy with that. So that's fine by me.
Okay.
When we talk about a throwback to the old sound, that's going back 25 years. Does it seem like it's just gone by in a flash?
Yeah.
Yeah,
I was just reflecting the other day about the first time we came to Australia in 94.
Yeah.
And gosh, that just seems not that long ago, and it was 20 years already.
Yeah.
With the rise in pop and dance music, in fact, we just had the Michael Jackson.
You mean the scourge?
The scourge
of
pop. I was going to say, how do you feel about that? But if you're calling it a scourge, that probably tells us everything we need to know.
I think what's difficult about it from insider point of view is it sends out a message to kids that that's sort of the only way to be successful in the music business, is to sort of package yourself, like the rise of those types of shows. You have to be this and you have to control. And quite frankly, if you look at the history of the music business, the biggest stars are individuals. There's only one Bob Marley. There's only one Ozzy Osbourne. You know, or a Madonna. You can't you can try, but you can't recreate them. Mm. And so the industry has sort of become about following rather than leading, and I think it's reflected in the sales.
He just did what I did, watching the Meghan Markle video.
Right. Yeah. The problem with the world is we're trying to be popular.
Yeah.
I'll just say I was struck by how much attachment he leads with in the interview, but then as the interview goes on, he reveals more and more frustration.
Yeah.
Just interrupting them to call something a scourge. This big popular movement, you know, but it starts with this thing like, well, I guess, you know, my album was, I thought it was this, the public thought it was this, maybe it's somewhere between. It's almost like a seasoned musician who just is like, okay, whatever, like I've been through this number, you know, like I get that this is how it goes, who fucking cares. But then, you know, he reveals like a real opinion, which is frustration.
I mean, this combination 4-6-9 Four-wing three is the most attachy of four could be,
right?
You know,
yeah.
So I mean, there are a lot of interviews where he's far more cutting. It seems like, you know, as he matured, he's a lot less antagonistic. But I mean, throughout the interview, he is still doing frustration, even though he's got a significant amount of attachment going on. But to that nested quality point that we talked about, his 6 and 9 is still going to be coming from the perspective of core frustration with gaze. So he's frustrated with he's talking a lot about attachment stuff, but still from the perspective of frustration.
He like 6 and 9 attuned to this universalist, like what is out there in pop culture, how my audience is seeing and receiving and orienting and interpreting my music, but you know, interpreted from this core frustration place.
The combination of frustration with attachment, it's more like a cultural critique, it seems like. Like it's pulling from culture or the universal, what's going on, but like, here's what's wrong with that. Here's what's shitty about the universal shit that's going on.
I want to make the point that I think, you know, when I was preparing for this and researching this guy, I was, you know, I watched a bunch of interviews and I was like, man, there's so much attachment here. So it was like hard. It was like the foreignness was almost hidden in these moments. But then I went and there are these YouTube videos you can see where he is yelling at the audience.
Yeah.
And it is just amazing. I mean, and it's all about, talk about frustration with gays. It is, every time he's yelling at the audience, it's always about like, you know, most people are here because they only give a shit about what I did 20 years ago. And I'm a different person now. And this is my music now. And I'm not going to play the old music. So fuck you.
Yep.
You know, and it's like 2-3 minute tirades where he's actually really alienating and disdainful towards the people who paid to see his show. And so I was thinking, I mean, it feels frustration in the heart center from all the force stuff that, you know, point of view that we were just talking about. But other than those moments, like I could see a person watching this interview and being like, is he really a fork? Cause it's kind of
hard.
Yeah.
Well, we did this with Nicole Kidman. It's the exact same typing, 413, Selfish Social, 6ix9ine. And it's the same kind of thing where, like, you know, she just sits there and then it'll just be like a...
Yeah.
Like, it's just not... Like, she's trying... You know what I mean? Like, it's not... It's that... It's kind of this withdrawn, like, okay, whatever. Like, you're wrong.
Anything goes these days when we can see Kanye West performing with Paul McCartney, where we can see Meghan Trainor doing the doo-wop song.
I know it's a bit early, but to me, it's headed basically towards a form of pornography. You have particularly women, young women sexualizing themselves earlier and earlier in really inappropriate ways to gain attention, because it's really about getting YouTube hits and stuff like that. So it's very, very difficult, because you're taking talented people at a very young age and you're saying your value is only in this particular lane. And I'm sorry, I just don't think that's the way it works.
Would you point the finger at any particular person when it comes to...
No, I think that
Nicki
the
Minaj,
no, you can't blame an artist for a chasing trend. You can only look at the industry and say that their lack of self responsibility ultimately has impacted a once great business and made it small. I would say if you actually look at the numbers of pop music, particularly, they're very small compared to video games, compared to movies. Our business is shrinking because it's getting a more lowest common denominator. And you can't blame people, but I don't really think that's what the great legacy and history of music is about.
Faces of the two interviewers are faces I have seen many times in my life. It's kind of like
he's just ruining their day, because it's supposed to be a light interview, morning interview, and he's dumping some heavy shit that just
pornography, the decline of the music industry, the
there you go.
They're here to talk about his new album.
Yeah.
They look so uncomfortable. It's hilarious.
Yeah, it's not even, I think what's interesting about 4-2 is it's like she's even trying to go with him, and she'll ask a question and he still thinks that she's wrong. Like, she'll be like, okay, well, like, who in particular? And he's like, well, no, we can't, you know, it's not like you can just choose
person.
Like, she can't say anything right for him.
Yes.
He can't simply look at this stupid woman in the pink shirt and be like, absolutely, you understand what I'm saying. He can't do that.
It feels like 4-6 stem there too.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you guys have him as social self-prez?
No, self-pres.
Yeah, but as we were watching this, I was thinking, like, we might want to look at social self-pres for him. But
yeah, we should. We should.
Probably, I was thinking the same thing.
Because I was wondering, because he's pretty different from Nicole Kidman in the sense that he's far more outspoken. And we also thought he had a one fix at one point.
So right.
Dr. Drew, welcome back to the show. Smart. It's always a pleasure to have you.
Thank you. It's great to see you. I'm looking a bit better than the ragged condition I was in during those Instagram lives, boy.
Well, I had no clue what you were dealing with, and we're all so sorry to hear that you...
You know what? I'm gonna stop you. Better me. Better me than many other people for a couple reasons. One, I'm just at the cusp where I'm going to have a bad time, but not so old that I'm going to have a really bad time. And I thought to myself, I'm so grateful because now I can see this from the patient perspective and the physician perspective, and hopefully I can help people as a result.
Pause.
That was not what I expected him to say. I'm gonna stop you right there. That I got it. Yeah. What?
That was crazy.
So
I was if that's not rejection with gays, I don't know what it. That's rejection with gays as fuck right there.
Yeah, from the from the point, so just to flesh out this theory, from the point of view of rejection with gays, what that is, you know, two is constructing a self-image and identity that protects itself from painful exogenous gaze. So like you can imagine a young two who you know, someone's important to them withdraws their gaze or misses them or something. It's so painful. Kind of like the eight in the body center basically says, okay, I'm never going to let that happen again. And I create a kind of castle wall barrier where I'm not letting other people's gaze in. And this is, John and I were talking about this, just blew our minds when we like kind of landed on this. Basically, what we think is going on with two from the point of view of rejection of gaze is that they're trying to reinforce a positive self-image as this person is selfless and giving. Mm-hmm. They're not letting in other people's interpretations of them, other people's regard of them. Mm. And what's going on is as they give something, they give their gift, and all they need is for you to accept it, for them to internally generate a proxy for your positive regard of them.
Oh,
so it kind of keeps them kind of within their own little walled gaze bubble.
Oh,
and so
that's interesting. Yeah. To where the other person's gaze is somewhat like an object.
It's like it bounces off the wall. It's like, or it's like somebody makes, you know, a two makes me a sandwich. All I have to do is say thank you and accept it, for the two to then reinforce their own self-image of I'm so giving.
Yeah. Mm.
They're not actually looking at how I'm regarding them. You know, they're not actually taking it in. And so the Ellen major interview that we're going to watch in a little while is really obvious, I think, from that point of view.
My grandmother's, I actually thought she was a two, but she's actually probably a 6-2-1, but two is secondary. So I think it's still kind of relevant, but like she'll do this thing where she needs you. She needs to feed you. She needs to offer you food. So as a kid, I would be like, oh, she gets happy when I eat her food. So, or like when I take food home at the end of the night. So at the end of the night, I would pack up my own container. This is super Italian. I'd pack up my own container of food and she'd be like, you want to take? And I was like, oh, I already packed up my own. And she'd be like, oh. And I was like, oh, she doesn't care that I took the food. She only cares that she could hand me the food.
There you go.
She's upset because I didn't take it from her in that moment. I already did it, so now I don't need her.
Right.
Yes. Yeah. So like the rejection of gays here, it's like this news anchor, I don't know his name, but he's asserting his regard of Dr. Drew is, oh, you poor thing, you were so sick.
Mm-hmm.
And Dr. Drew does not let that in.
Nope.
Because what it threatens is his self-image of a person who benefited from this experience and can now use it to give to other people to reinforce a self-image of I'm so giving.
Yep.
And so that is rejection of gaze right there.
Yeah, that was such an amazing, like a really pinpointed great example.
To conceptualize what each of the object relations are doing in each center, if attachment is saying, you know, I'll adapt to the center, and frustration is saying, God, this center sucks and it's not enough and it's irritating and I can't fix it. Rejection's like, I don't need this whole fucking center. I don't need it. Mm-hmm. I don't need gaze.
Yeah.
I don't need the holding environment. You know what I mean? Yeah.
Yeah. But I do want to stay connected to it, and I do so by offering something and having the external environment take it from me as a way to stay.
Right.
Yeah.
Because you do need it. It's false that you don't need it. So you have to find a way to. Yeah.
So it's the one way sort of possession dynamic we've talked about. Creating leverage, creating gaze for yourself. So it's like it's a one way dynamic.
Two have aired, right?
Two episodes have aired. That's right.
Okay. So because I just watched them and.
Okay. Can you just stop for 1 second? Yeah. So like, look at how intense he is looking at Ellen. Like,
totally. Mm-hmm.
It's like, it's almost like from his point of view, you're not looking at me. I'm looking at you. You know,
yeah,
I'm the one.
There you go. That's it.
That's rejection of gaze right there. And he's already touched her on the arm. He's already leaning forward. You know, and what you're about to see is he's about to talk about some patients of his that he has helped in this kind of recovery program. And it's all about his offering.
So don't ask too much.
I won't, because I like to keep up in real time. I don't like to get things ahead of time. But so it's all done. You've already
finished.
We actually
did it. Yeah, we actually did it last spring. We did Sober House following that too. Mm-hmm. And this was one of the tougher groups we've treated. There was a lot of people with deep resistances. There were severe addictions. See, poor Tom Sizemore, who's just—I don't know if you ever met Tom. He's one of the greatest guys.
Yeah.
Sober. Yeah.
And when he's using,
yes.
He does some wild stuff.
So Tom Sizemore, who we just saw in that clip.
He's an asshole.
Mackenzie Phillips.
Mackenzie, and there's been some news about her since we treated her,
right.
Of course.
And Heidi Fleiss.
Heidi Fleiss.
And Dennis Rodman. Yeah.
You don't want to do this, but you have to, man. I have to write a report to the court saying that you satisfactorily completed treatment.
Right.
I'm not going to do that now.
Uh-huh. But he doesn't think he needs to be there.
He does. I actually end up getting some brain scans on him to show him the alcohol-related damage that he has. And he does. I make no mistake about it. He's got a severe problem.
And what kind of damage is that from alcohol? Like memory or denial or what?
Well, in particular, I actually did what's called a SPECT scan, and we showed him the surface of his brain was gone from the injury related, which alcohol does. I mean, alcohol is one of the drugs of abuse. We don't think about it as one of the only drugs of abuse that really is damaging to all human tissue.
Mm-hmm. So he, when he sees that, does he then take that in, or does he?
We slowly eroded away. I mean, mm-hmm. He at no point did he have any kind of an aha moment. I mean, uh-huh. Dennis has got a lot of stuff going on. I mean, uh-huh. and he does, I like Dennis, and mm-hmm. I eventually sort of forge a relationship with him. We actually bring his mother in later on in Sober House.
Really?
And that she's a wonderful woman, and that has a dramatic impact on him.
Well, I can't wait to see this right now.
Okay.
It looks like.
God, she's wonderful. She's wonderful.
Flattery.
I'm struck by a lot of things. First of all, he is freely volunteering some very personal information about Dennis Rodman. and basically assembling a kind of presentation of how much he did for Dennis, and it's like the entire thing is trying to pierce through Dennis's not inability to see how much he needs this mm-hmm. help, which he can deliver. Yeah. And there's almost like just, I don't see him having any receptivity to the way Ellen is receiving this. This is
or
part
anyone.
Of the rejection thing too. He's like,
including Dennis.
This is my offering. This is how it is. There's almost like this is the reality. Like Dennis needs me and the thing that I'm offering. It's not really a conversation. It's a report.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it almost feels overwhelming. What I've been reflecting on with twos that we've typed is that they're taking up so much space that it feels overconfident in the heart space, that it's penetrating, and he's talking so much about like people's personal shit that it doesn't. There's no room but to go deeper into what he's presenting.
Something too, like these little facial expressions he does, like after he talks about Dennis, like this one right here, like. You know, like, it's like, you know, it's that superego, like, I'm really doing everything I can, and I really love this, you know, and Joseph, you're, you know, mimicking it, like, that's all.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Yeah. No, yeah, that's it. Yeah, it's just, you're right, all of these, I can't even remember all of them, but there are so many of these micro expressions of care and concern, mm-hmm. and the second he says something that is, say, that could be construed as harsh, he has to soften it by saying, but I really care about this person,
yep.
You know, or mm-hmm. like I'm coming down, but you know, it's because I've developed this real rapport. He did this, the, like, I don't know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.